Good evening, everyone. My name is Linda McKee, and I'm the Executive Dean for the Faculty of Social Science and Public Policy. And it's my pleasure to welcome everyone this evening in person and online. And it's a particular pleasure, as this is the third annual lecture for the Freeman Air and Space Institute. And we're delighted this evening to have the Chief of the Air Staff. Now, this is a really busy time for you, I appreciate, and my colleague Wynne Bowen is going to come to the stage in a moment and talk about your history, your biography. It falls to me at this point to say that you came into role in June of this year. And so we're delighted that you're taking this opportunity, 6 months into role, to talk through your strategy, your ideas for the future, and to share that with the audience. So we're looking forward to a very exciting question and answer session after the lecture. Now, I'm going to be around this evening, and as I say, I'm delighted on behalf of the faculty that we're here this evening to welcome you, and we'll be recording the lecture as well. So I'm now going to pass on to my colleague, Professor Wynne Bowen, and thank you, Wynne, for introducing Rich to us. Yeah.
Great. Thank you, Linda, and good evening to everybody, CAS. I'm one of the co-directors of the Freeman Aerospace Institute here at King's. My colleague David Jordan, the other co-director, can't make it today. He apologises. But thank you for coming this evening to King's. I've got to do a bit of admin. If there's a fire alarm, walk to the back of the room, follow the green signs to get out of the building, and the restrooms are either on this floor or the floor down. So we are delighted, obviously, as the Freeman Institute and as King's, to be hosting our annual event with the Chief of the Air Staff. It was not so long ago that we hosted Sir Rich at FASI back in February, before he took over as Chief, and when he was in the role of Deputy Commander for Capability and People. And his topic then, I think, was what next for the RAF. So probably have a bit more of that, perhaps, this evening. So it's a real pleasure to welcome back Sir Rich. And to introduce him again to you this evening. So Sir Rich joined the RAF in 88 as a university cadet and studied engineering at Clare College, Cambridge. He spent his early career in frontline roles working on Nimrod, Tornado and the Harrier Force and served as station commander at RAF Wittering, where he was also the RAF's logistics force commander. He's had a range of staff appointments in the Ministry of Defence, Air Command and in equipment acquisition support, and he was the Assistant Chief of Air Staff during the 2015 SDSR, with responsibility for the strategic coherence and coordination of the RAF and planning for the RAF 100 centenary. He has been the Deputy Chief of Defence Staff for Military Capability, and as I said before this appointment, as Chief of the Air Staff, he was a Deputy Commander, Capability and People at Air Command, with responsibility for strategic planning and delivery of all aspects of RAF capability, people, equipment, infrastructure, and training. And as Linda said, he was appointed in June of this year as the Chief of the Air Staff. And it's important to note, on top of all this accomplishment, that he was appointed to the Military Division of the Most Honourable Order of the Bath as a commander in 2017 and as a Knight Commander in 2023. So Sir Rich is going to talk for about 30 minutes or so. It's on the record, which is always good. And then we'll go into a discussion session, which will be chaired by Dr. Sophie Antrobus, my colleague, research fellow in the Freeman Air and Space Institute. So without any further ado, I'll hand over. Sir Richard.
Oh, there we go. That's it, I'm finished. Linda and Wynne, thank you very much for that kind introduction, and thank you all for coming. And thank you very much indeed to the Freeman Air and Space Institute for your help and advice in my first 6 months, as well as for hosting the event this evening. I know that last year my predecessor ran this as a sort of moderated question and answer session, and we were going to do that this year, but I was conscious that although I've spent a lot of time in my first few months talking to those in the Royal Air Force about my approach and my focus, I haven't, apart from the short speeches I made at the Global Air and Space Chief Conference and at DSCI, talked really and set out my thinking to those outside the Air Force. And nearly 6 months into the role, as you've heard, this evening seemed like an excellent opportunity to do so. So I'm going to start by talking about the strategic context. Understanding that strategic context is where I started in my thinking about what I needed to do as CAS. And in my view, this helps us to understand what might be expected of the Royal Air Force now and in the future. I'll then go on to talk about the RAF's readiness for the demands that will be placed on it, before concluding by setting out my focus and priorities as CAS based on that analysis. You've heard a little bit from Wim, but in terms of rules of engagement, I'll talk for actually a bit longer, about 35 minutes, which will all be on the record. And while normally I like to do these things without notes, I'm actually going to use my notes this evening, mostly so I keep to time, and so I can leave us time for questions at the end, which will be off the record. So let me start then by talking about the strategic context. Inevitably, there are different perspectives on the strategic environment. But there is, at least in the West, I think, a fairly commonly held view that the last few years has seen a return of great power competition. Our Prime Minister, Rishi Sunak, has said that we are facing a world defined by danger, disorder, and division. But perhaps the most important point for me is what he says next. We need to out-cooperate and out-compete our adversaries. Now, I know that every generation thinks it's living through the most tumultuous and significant moments in history. But as I look back on my 30 years of my career, it does feel like, with a war in Europe, war in the Middle East, and the threat of war in the South China Sea, we do live in a world which is more unstable and therefore more dangerous than it has been for a long time. The warrior monk, General David Petraeus, has said recently that the Western world faces the greatest number and the most complex array of threats we have ever seen. Understanding the forces shaping the strategic context and the vectors of change are, I think, helpful in understanding what the RAF might need to be ready for in the future. The integrated review in 2021 and its refresh in 2023 clearly articulate some of these forces, the direction of travel and what they might mean for the UK. In Europe, there are, in some ways, strong stabilising influences in terms of greater economic and political integration, particularly with the former Soviet bloc countries, as well as the expansion and strength of NATO. And while Russia is arguably weaker, certainly militarily, than it has been for a long time, declining powers led by authoritarian leaders with a decreasing grip on reality have always posed significant threats to stability. So it seems to me that the position in Europe is one characterised by uncertainty and risk. More broadly, as the integrated review points out, the world is seeing a shift in the balance of power to the east, principally as a consequence of the growing economic and military strength of China. The same shifts are also true of technology. While in the past we could expect to see technology that drove operational advantage that the West has enjoyed for decades come from government labs in North America or, to some extent, the UK and Europe. What we're seeing now is the commercial sector increasingly driving the development of technology that will generate operational advantage. This has democratised access to technologies that threaten the West's historic operational advantage. And China, as well as Russia, has not been shy in exporting its technology to other states and non-state actors. This shift in the balance of power leads some to ask the rather simple question whether our priority in preparing for the future and for the future fight should be focused on Europe or China. But as the Prime Minister highlighted in the Integrated Review refresh, the prosperity and security of the Euro-Atlantic and Indo-Pacific are inextricably linked. As an Air Force, therefore, it seems to me that we have to be ready to contribute to enhancing stability and facing threats globally, not just in Europe. So what are these threats that we need to be ready for, and what demands might we expect to be made on us? Well, we have spent the last 25 years fighting different kinds of wars to the one that is going on the eastern edge of Europe right now. We've enjoyed air supremacy in most of the operations we've been involved in. We've been able to concentrate our forces on a smaller number of bases, and we've relied on largely unimpeded logistics and contracted supply chains. This picture is of Kandahar. At its peak, it had almost 400 aircraft and 29,000 people permanently based there. We did that because it was efficient, and the greatest threat we faced was from indirect fire and insurgents. Those assumptions and luxuries that have defined the character of conflicts over the last two decades can't be taken for granted now. We've seen in Ukraine how long-range aviation and cruise missiles, alongside cheaper mass attacks by drones, have been used to target critical national infrastructure and the Ukrainian Air Force. We know the story of the first night of attacks by Russia on Ukraine. It started with a wave of cyber attacks to disrupt Ukrainian network infrastructures. The military operation began at 0500 local with an initial wave of 100 standoff missiles launched from land, sea and air. These targeted command and control facilities, air defence sites around a dozen air bases and facilities in Odessa. To give you a sense of the scale and what it might mean for a country like ours, the distance between Kherson and Kyiv is the same as the distance between London and Newcastle. I know that we have to be careful drawing too many conclusions from the war in Ukraine. I heard a phrase last year that stuck with me. People draw the lessons from the war in Ukraine that they're comfortable with. So even now, 21 months into the war, we should be careful not to be too definitive in our conclusions. When I talked to the CAS fellows recently, someone suggested that we should talk about observations rather than lessons from Ukraine. I think this is wise advice. But if we see these observations in the context of the long history of warfare, then I think there are conclusions we can draw that should shape our thinking about the future of air and space power and the direction the RAF must move in. Whatever we might think of the character of the war in Ukraine, there is one conclusion I think we can safely draw. We do not want to fight like that. The scenes from the front line in Ukraine are reminiscent of the First World War. Sergei Plokhy, in his article earlier this year, described it as a 19th century war fought with 20th century tactics and 21st century weaponry. The fact is that neither side has managed to gain control of the air. Forces on both sides are locked in a struggle of offence and defence, where defence has the advantage and offence becomes a huge challenge without control of the air and without the ability to strike at the enemy's deep. In June, Richard Kemp, a journalist writing for the Daily Telegraph, reminded us that almost every attacking force from the Second World War onwards has succeeded only with air superiority. I was delighted to hear the Chief of the General Staff make this point when I sat next to him at the House of Commons Defence Select Committee 2 weeks ago about where air power and control of the air would allow us to fight differently to the way the Ukrainians are having to fight right now. I'd also argue, therefore, we can conclude from what we've seen in Ukraine, what we know of history and how a war against China might play out, that air and space power really, really matter. Now, there are some who argue that Russia, weakened by the war in Ukraine, offers less of a threat now than it has done for many years. This is certainly true for the Russian army, which has been badly damaged by the war. The CGS said in the Defence Select Committee hearing, the destruction of much of the Russian army has given us the gift of time. But the Russian Air Force remains largely intact, and we would be naive to think that Russia and other nations are not learning from its mistakes. So if we don't want to fight that kind of war, the best way must be to deter our adversaries from using military force against us. Deterrence is therefore fundamental to our security, and the RAF must be ready to play its part. We need to be ready and be seen to be ready to fight and win. In our doctrine, deterrence relies on the credibility of our capability, our preparedness to use it, and our ability to communicate that effectively to our potential adversaries. The challenge, in peacetime in particular, is knowing how much is enough. War is always more costly, in every sense, than deterrence. Just look at Ukraine. But it's hard to be sure what risks need to be minimised and which gaps closed. Despite how difficult it is to answer, it is a question we need to ask ourselves, especially in peacetime. So if the importance of deterrence and the fact that air and space power really, really matter in shaping the conflict, and these are the first two big strategic observations we can make, what are other insights from the war in Ukraine, alongside our understanding of history, can we draw about what the Air Force needs to do over the next few years? There's much work and debate right across defence, and I'm sure in Moscow and Beijing, to help understand the key insights. But I offer four more key observations for now, and we may return to them again in questions. The first is that the side that is able to adapt the fastest is likely to prevail. Professor Michael Howard said, no matter how clearly one thinks, it's impossible to anticipate precisely the character of future conflict. The key is not to be so far off the mark that it becomes impossible to adjust once the character is revealed. This is an area of keen interest for me, given my roles over the past few years. There's a lot written and a lot said about this topic, and the topic of innovation in particular, with comparisons drawn from the tech sector and breathless claims about the next big technological leap forward driving a revolution in military affairs. The reality is likely to be more prosaic. Creating the kind of operational pull we see in conflict in peacetime is hard. What we must ensure is that we have the foundations and skills in place to drive adaptation at a speed that will overwhelm an adversary when the time comes. This will require us to think differently about the risks that we are prepared to tolerate in adapting our capability for the threats we face. Storm Shadow, for example, was fitted to Ukrainian Su-24 aircraft in a matter of months, when it will take several years before we see Meteor missiles integrated onto F-35. My second additional observation is that stockpiles, production capacity and logistics support will be key factors in the outcome of the war in Ukraine. And there are things that we need to pay more attention to. Over the past decade or more, we have made judgments about how long operations would last and the rates of effort we should plan on. The war in Ukraine has shown that they all need to be revisited. My third observation is that operational agility is essential to survival. I don't entirely buy Dr. Jack Watling of Roos's argument that there's nowhere to hide on the modern battlefield. The practical evidence doesn't support that extreme view, but it's certainly getting harder, and the price of failing to hide is getting higher. Camouflage, concealment, and deception have always been important in war. We will need to relearn these skills. My fourth and final observation for now is about the need for a credible integrated air and missile defence capability. Russia launched more than 1,100 missiles at Ukrainian targets over the first 21 days of the war. In Europe and in the Far East, a credible integrated air and missile defence is fundamental to any deterrence by denial posture. So given this context and observations, what are the conclusions that we can draw about the challenges and missions that the RAF needs to be ready for now and in the future? It seems clear to me that the importance of and demand for air and space power is higher now than it's been for many years. We need to be ready to meet that demand. At the same time, the operational challenges for us are growing as our adversaries develop increasingly capable systems and learn from their failures. In the future, we will have to fight for control of the air. Without control of the air, we cannot deliver other military effects either through the air or on land or at sea. But with increasingly sophisticated defences, that fight will be harder. And when we win control of the air, it's likely to be limited geographically and temporally. While the war in Ukraine illustrates clearly the threats we might face in Europe now, the operational imperatives and challenges are the same for all the Western Air Forces wherever we might expect to fight. We know that we will have to break through our enemy's integrated air and missile defences. We know that our fixed bases face threats from long-range missiles and that we will face hybrid attacks targeting our industrial base and our logistics chains. So my conclusion, to put it simply, is that we need to be ready to do more, and it's going to be harder. Now, we should not expect to do this on our own, but we will need to be better integrated across all five operational domains, land, sea, air, space, and cyberspace, and with our allies. That's why I'm committed to the idea of multi-domain integration, and why NATO has been at the heart of my thinking in terms of international engagement. NATO is the strongest and most successful defensive political and military alliance in history. The demonstrable strength of the alliance is central to our ability to deter Russia from doing something daft. So if we know what we need to do, how ready is the RAF to meet these challenges? Well, while the RAF might be the smallest it's been in its history in terms of numbers of aircraft, it's unquestionably has the most modern and capable equipment it has ever fielded. The RAF has enjoyed a remarkable period of investment over the past decade or more. Almost every platform is new. This is an enviable position. But with the notable exception of GCAP, the Global Combat Air Programme, this period of investment in new aircraft is coming to an end. That means that the platforms we have today will be the ones we will need to fight with over the next 10 to 15 years. If we do nothing to enhance their capability, we'll lose that operational advantage. The solution is not likely to be new, large-scale programmes. Instead, I think we have to focus on incrementally improving the capability of our current force structure. As I mentioned earlier, there is much breathless talk about new and emerging technologies like quantum that will deliver this revolution in military affairs. But in many cases, the technology we need already exists. The challenge is integrating it into our platforms that have closed architectures that are controlled by original equipment manufacturers. In my view, for what it's worth, I think there are four technologies that we need to harness to ensure that we can enhance our capability and sustain or gain operational advantage. These are firstly space, the central importance of which has been amply demonstrated in the war in Ukraine. The second is digital, by which I mean the full gamut of capability from exploiting data to harnessing artificial intelligence. Third is synthetics, to enhance individually, but more importantly, collective training. And finally, automated systems, which offer a route to greater mass and lethality at lower cost. I expect to see crewed platforms teamed with uncrewed systems before the end of the decade. But if the need for new and improved capability as well as air and space power more generally is likely to grow, how ready are we to meet that demand? By any comparison I've seen or done, the RAF is more productive than our allies. Well, we can make direct comparisons by looking at nations that operate the same platforms like Typhoon or C-17. We see the UK and the Royal Air Force flies more and has more efficient support solutions. But it's clear that with no new platforms coming into service after 2025, for more than a decade, we must get more out of what we've got. We spent the last 25 years leaning our force structure and support processes, optimising the RAF around force generation for deployed operations around the world. This has been delivered through greater centralisation, outsourcing to industry and leaning our processes and systems. That work was absolutely essential. The legacy systems in the 1990s had their roots in the models of the 1970s and 1980s and were hugely inefficient. In many ways, the RAF has led the world in thinking about things like availability contracting and performance-based logistics. But by making ourselves leaner and more efficient, we risk being more vulnerable to the kind of threats I've described. We have, over the past two decades or more, become more static, more predictable, and therefore more targetable by our adversaries, from long-range aviation, cruise missiles, mass drone attacks, and cyber attacks of our support solutions. There are, though, partly because of the lean journey we've been on, opportunities to get more out of what we've got. And we owe it to the taxpayer to do that. We've already seen examples where we're doing this well. As CDS set out in his speech at the International Air Tattoo in the summer, we've seen a 100% increase. It's a 100% increase in the operational flying of the Typhoon Force over the past 18 months. On River Joint, we've increased flying rates by over 100% over the last couple of years. Some of these improvements have come from simple changes to process and organisation. But delivering sustained and broad improvements requires an enterprise-wide approach that looks across all the factors that affect our outputs. There is no simple solution. Success will come from a systematic focus on modernising and enabling the workforce, exploiting data and synthetics, and transforming our relationship with industry. That is the focus of our optimised programme, which is being led by our operational commander, not by the Deputy Chief of the Air Staff, as might have been the case in the past. My objective is, therefore, to enhance both our capability and capacity with the resources we have. But I would be deluded if I were to argue that we can deliver significantly more capability or more output with no resources. Defence has made that mistake before. But what I think we can do is identify where relatively small amounts of investment, at least when compared to the cost of major new equipment programmes, can be focused to have the biggest impact on outputs. This isn't showy or breathlessly exciting, but it will make a real difference and meaningful difference to what the RAF can do to deter our adversaries and protect our country. So while I've focused so far on the strategic context and the need and opportunities to both enhance our capability and capacity, while I've been going around the Air Force and we've seen several thousand people in my first few months face to face, I've been very open and honest in talking to our people inside the RAF about the challenges, the very real challenges that we face over the next few years. If you go to pretty much any RAF station, one of the first things that people tell you about is the state of the infrastructure. More than half of the infrastructure in defence and in the Royal Air Force is over 50 years old. Some years ago, defence stopped investing in preventative maintenance and instead adopted a fix-on-fail approach. More recently, partly associated with responsibility for investment in infrastructure coming back to the commands, we've seen marked increases in the amount of money spent on infrastructure right across defence, and particularly the Royal Air Force, where our 10-year forward programme of spending has doubled from £3 billion to £6 billion, thanks to the prioritisation by my two predecessors. Now, while that will make a tangible difference, I've been honest with the RAF that this is an issue that will not be solved quickly. In fact, it will only be solved by maintaining our long-term plans to increase investment in infrastructure. But perhaps the challenge that concerns me most is people. With private sector wages growing more rapidly than the public sector, and with over 1 million job vacancies in the UK at the start of the year, we were seeing in the summer rates of outflow much higher than historic norms. And while the RAF achieved around 90% of its recruitment target last financial year, outperforming the other services by quite a margin, data from this year shows that the RAF is not immune to the challenges to recruitment that the Army and Navy saw last year. The pressure is particularly acute in highly skilled areas such as engineering and cyberspace professions. Although the most recent data shows that exit rates are starting to fall, we cannot be complacent. Of all the things we need to get right, this is the one that is closest to the top of my list of priorities. So far tonight, I've talked and focused on what Staff College graduates might describe as the physical component of fighting power, the equipment, capability, infrastructure, and numbers of people. But as most Staff College graduates will tell you, fighting power also depends on the conceptual and the moral components too. We've been thinking hard in the RAF and with the help of the Freeman Air and Space Institute about how we're going to fight to deal with the threats that I've described. That thinking is now captured in our new air operating concept. In UK doctrine, a concept is simply an idea about how we should fight to win. It is not the answer. The point of developing the concept is to explore, understand and define defence problems and to identify potential solutions. It should provide a headmark or a North Star to help us develop how we fight, how we train, as well as what we fight with. I'm certain that our air operating concept doesn't provide all of the answers, but I think it asks the right questions and provides a strong foundation for discussion, testing, experimentation, and for development of our capability and how we fight. At its core, the air operating concept recognises that fundamental to our success will be the ability to gain control of the air. As I described earlier, that control might be limited in time and geography, but our core task and central purpose as an air force must be to win control of the air. Without it, we cannot strike our adversaries from the air or even, as I say, from the land and sea. So we talk in the air operating concept, perhaps a bit grandly, about our theory of winning in this future operating environment. At its heart, our theory is based on the work and teaching of Colonel John Boyd. I know that John Boyd will be well known to most in the audience. Although his contribution to military thinking is profound, I'm sure he was not an easy man to live or work with. Robert Coram, in his 2002 biography, described Boyd as loud, abrasive and profane. One of the difficulties we have in understanding Boyd's teaching is he wrote almost nothing down. His patterns of conflict brief contain the logic and fundamentals of his philosophy and was his most important work. He was fascinated by examples of numerically superior forces losing to weaker ones. The common thread he found in these battles was that none of the victorious commanders threw their forces head-to-head against the enemy. Instead, they used deception, speed, fluidity of action, and strength against weakness. They used tactics that disorientated and confused. Tactics that, to use Boyd's own words, caused the enemy to unravel before the fight. Central to his thinking was the idea of this two-way relationship between observer and observed, and the chaos that can ensue if the rate of change in the outside world was faster than the observer's ability to adapt. His most famous and perhaps least understood legacy from this work is the observe, orient, decide, act loop. The OODA loop is often seen as a simple, one-dimensional cycle. That's how I was taught it at Staff College. But it is much, or at least I understood it at Staff College. But it is actually, as one of my staff teachers is in the audience, I thought I'd better say that. But it's much more profound and nuanced than that, which his original sketch indicates. The key thing to his thinking about the cycle was the need to execute it in a way that gets inside the mind and the decision cycle of the adversary. That way, an adversary is dealing with outdated, irrelevant information which leads to confusion and disorientation. Boyd's philosophy is encapsulated in our air operating concept in the idea of decision superiority. Put simply, this is about making faster and better decisions. But it's as much about training and education as it is about technology and connectivity. And while our air operating concept is based around the core theme of decision superiority, it also includes a second pillar of supporting concepts of advantage through agility, integration, and resilience. Operational agility is not perfectly defined, but we know it when we see it in Ukraine, for example, when an aircraft lands at a different base to the one it took off every time, or when we operate Typhoon from a road in Finland. This concept is encapsulated in our thinking and work on agile combat employment. This is a term coined by the USAF as it thinks about how it will fight and win a war against China. But the principles of speed, of action and flexibility are probably as old as warfare itself. Integrated action is also going to provide us with some operational advantage. We already know that integrating across action across air, space and cyberspace has a force multiplying effect. We do it routinely in the combined air operation centres in the Middle East, and we can see it in use in Ukraine. By integrating action across all five domains and multinationally, we massively increase the opportunities to probe, test and shape our enemies, generating uncertainty, confusion and chaos, and ultimately leading to them, as Boyd put it, unravelling. Finally, when we talk about resilience, it means being able to continue flying and fighting in a protracted conflict. The increase in investment that the government has made in stockpiles are the first steps in this. But we'll need to think about resilience consciously rather than simply building in inefficiency or fat. And we will need to do it in concert with our allies and with industry. Let me finish this part about talking about RAF's readiness for the threats we face by saying something about the moral component of fighting power in the RAF. All of the thinking and capability I've described is nothing without motivated and resilient people with the right mindset. It's clear from my time back in Air Command and the many thousands of people that I've met in my first few months as CAS that we are blessed with some brilliant, professional, highly skilled, determined and innovative people. When they've been tested operationally, they've succeeded. Stories of leaders at every level are inspiring, from the loadmaster who talked down the Sudanese army at Wadi Sadina, threatening to turn his aircraft into a colander during Op Polar Bear, to those we saw tested in Op Pitting in the brilliant TV documentary. I don't worry about the ability of our men and women to step up for the fight. But it's also true to say that over the years, we seem to have made it harder for ourselves to do what we need to do, with an accretion of process and unnecessary bureaucracy. This is frustrating and stifling for our people. But it's also not easy to fix. All of the process was put in place for a reason, and good people thinking they were doing the right thing. Part of the solution is simply about making sure that we are focused on what matters most, i.e. being ready to fly and fight. But some of it is about getting the balance right between operational imperatives and operating risks. Our friends in Ukraine have shown us how to adapt fast when faced with new operational challenges, but it's required risks to be taken. Over the past four decades, the RAF has mercifully become safer. We've done that through better process, better regulation, and better technology. But I wonder if we need to change something about how we understand and manage risk in the future. Now, to illustrate the point about the changes in our work environment, I want to share a video that I know some of you have seen. Back in 1975, on Blue Peter, John Noakes climbed up Nelson's Column. 40 years later, Connie Hugg did the same thing. Go for it.
Right, well, I'm hard-hatted up and ready to go. It took 3 weeks to put this scaffolding up, and under it lies one of London's best-known landmarks. It's 250 steps up to the top, so I've got a way to go.
There you go. It's a long way, isn't it?
It is, yeah.
How high is it?
Oh, it's about 180 feet, isn't it?
Is it? How are the ladders fixed on?
They're
quite firmly.
They're roped quite firmly around the actual column itself.
Yeah.
And they're very secure, like, you know?
I know some of you have seen it before, but I love it, particularly the bit where he ties him on with a rope. But once is enough tonight, thanks. So if you're asking me to climb Nelson's Column, I'd prefer to do it with the scaffolding. But in war, we might not have or might not be able to wait 3 weeks for the scaffolding to be erected. There's a lot I'm trying to do to cut away unnecessary bureaucracy, but we're also consciously designing capability for what we might describe as high-risk operations. We know that when the war starts, the balance between the operating and operational risks that we're prepared to tolerate in order to deliver the mission change. Having capability ready on the shelf, but that might not have been tested and proven to a factor of 10 to the minus 6 or 10 to the minus 8, but we know enough to say it will work, will save us time and money and could give us an operational edge in the fight. So let me finish by summarising my focus and priorities given the strategic context I've set out and our strengths and challenges as an Air Force. It seems clear to me that we should plan on the demands on us increasing and the operational challenges growing. Put simply, we have to be ready to do more and it's going to be harder. While we have great kit and great people, we face some very real challenges over the next few years. So against this backdrop, there are five key strands to my work as CAS. And this starts with a focus on what matters most. The RAF is about flying and fighting. We need to be ready and seen to be ready to fight and win. Our core role is control of the air. Without it, we cannot deliver other military effects. This operational mindset and focus needs to pervade all that we do. Everyone in the RAF has a part to play in ensuring that we are ready to fly and fight. Second, we can only do this if we get the basics right. That means having the right people, infrastructure and training. These things are my near-term priority. Third, we must get more out of the force structure we have. The country needs it and we owe it to the taxpayer. That change can only be truly successful if it is enterprise-wide and a whole force effort. As I said, there is no simple solution. Success will require a systematic and system-wide focus on modernising and enabling the workforce, exploiting data, synthetics, prioritising our efforts, measuring progress properly, and transforming our relationship with industry. Fourth, we need to exploit the opportunities new technology presents to enhance our current capabilities. Our experience in assisting Ukraine shows what can be done at speed with the right focus, priority, and attitude to risk. In many cases, the technology is proven. It's traditional, cultural and systemic barriers to adoption that risks us not exploiting the benefits of vital technology. Rapid, continuous capability insertion and technology insertion will be our mantra. Finally, underpinning all of this, and perhaps the hardest thing to do, is to develop a mindset, an attitude to risk and to process that matches the operational threat we face, not our peacetime approach. So I hope this has given you an insight into my thinking and direction and sowed some seeds for some good questions. Thank you all very much.
Rich, thank you so much for a real wide-ranging lecture, giving us a really good feel for what you see as priorities. I think there would... much agreement around the room about all of that, and certainly for me, your final point about operational risk and dealing with risk is really hugely important and something I'm looking at myself. It's lovely to see you all. This always feels like the beginning of the run-up to Christmas when we have our CAS annual lecture. Professor John Gearson, Head of Security Studies, would you like to say a couple of words of thanks?
Close.
We need to put steps on that side.
Thanks, Sophie. And Rich, thank you very much indeed. Thank you for your talk this evening, but thank you also for your continuing support of the Freeman Air and Space Institute, a really important initiative of the School of Security Studies, and I speak as one of the founding co-directors of FASI, and it remains a great significant importance to the school and to the wider faculty, as I'm sure the Dean will agree. I was reflecting as you started your speech that you came to speak at King's earlier in the year, and straight after that it was announced you were going to be Chief of the Air Staff. And now here you are again, making a speech at King's, and I'm waiting for announcements that will follow, perhaps in the new year. If our political leaders are anything to go by, anything could happen as we move forward. mindful that I'm supposed to get people into the reception as soon as possible, I've just got about 3 points I'd like to make, and then we'll move on. I think you took us very well into the escalating strategies that are facing us, this competition that is changing. And you talked about every generation regarding its challenges as the most important. I think one thing that can be agreed is that the air and space issue has certainly come to greater centrality than when we were discussing setting up the Freeman Air and Space Institute, if that was possible, because it obviously was very important to us at the time. But even taking us beyond Ukraine, the proliferation of drone and rocket technology that we're seeing used in the Middle East at the moment, you know, shows us just how this is not just an upward move, it's also a downward move of technology, which is going to change maybe not war fighting for the RAF, but certainly conflict management for many parts of the world. It's also significant for me to have heard you mention deterrence by denial. As an early lecturer at Shrivenham in the late 1990s, I used to say the only people who understand deterrence by denial are the RAF, and I got sort of blank looks from the land and even the naval people there. But I didn't hear it mentioned, and I'm very happy that my academic career has not been a total failure, because 27 years later, a chief of the air staff mentions the centrality of deterrence by denial in a public speech. So I'm delighted to have seen that come forward. Many of the things that you've highlighted we'll be taking forward in our second London Defence Conference next May, building on the success of last year. But the big difference will be that there will be an air and space panel as part of that conference, and we look forward to the RAF being able to support it as we move forward. And of course, we'll be talking about it through with our partners in FASI. Now, we are named the Freeman Air and Space Institute, and it was that airman, Wilfred Freeman, who was an RAF leader in a time of, funny to mention it, increasing uncertainty, strategic change, and technological change, and also a blurring of the gap between military, decision makers, political, and others, and industrial capabilities. You know, he is often revered as somebody who got more things right than wrong, but some of the platforms that he supported brought him into a lot of criticism, of course. And it is interesting to see that he is one of those leading figures from the military who transcended that military security space at an early time, and very successfully, despite that criticism that he faced. You stated that it's not a choice between Europe and the Indo-Pacific as we move forward. But I think from our perspective, it would be good to see a little bit more discussion about the air and space developments as part of the AUKUS and successor structures that the UK is supporting. I know the RAF is involved, but I think giving some more profile to it would be valuable. It's something that my colleagues in the Security and Defence Plus Alliance with Arizona University and New South Wales in Australia are looking to do as three universities interested in this area. I also saw a lot of smiles around the room when you mentioned people don't join the Air Force to make a lot of money. They don't do it in academia either, of course. But I think as we move into risk-taking, we also have to remember our people. And I speak as a leader in a university, to a leader in a military organization, that we mustn't take our people for granted. And we do have to think about them when we take, as you called it, careful but managed risks. I would just observe that moving from an era of risk management that we have existed in probably for three decades into an era of risk-taking is a brave thing to do. And I know speakers hate it when people say to them, you've been very brave. But I just think it is an interesting and challenging suggestion that we should move to be risk takers a little bit more with the challenges that we face. So thank you for supporting FASI by being here today. Thank you to you and Link Taylor, our main point of contact in supporting the work of FASI. Of course, FASI, whilst it depends a great deal on the support of the Royal Air Force, it also gets support from the university, of course, and other donations are gratefully received. So if anybody in the audience is interested in supporting the work of the Freeman Air and Space Institute, please take the opportunity whilst you're drinking our free wine to discuss with us how we might be able to do research in areas that you do. Rich, thank you very much for coming back.
Thank you.